Yeah, I want to see.
10 years from now, we'll definitely sound like get off my lawn kind of guys.
Maybe they can AI us, and when we're long gone, we can just keep in the shed going. Hey, everybody, welcome back from the shed. I'm Troy.
This is Dave.
Howdy.
Today, we're going to talk about the top three signature rock star moves. But before we get started, I want you to leave your pics below so you can match ours. Also, make sure to subscribe to the channel and like this video.
There are so many signature rock star moves out there, but I got three great ones. What about you, Troy?
It was hard to pick. I mean, when you came up with this topic, I was like, well, you know, I can pick three, of course, but they're probably going to be the same as yours, but maybe not, because when I looked at the list, I was like, oh, yeah, I forgot about this guy, and I forgot about this girl, or whatever. So, yeah, let's get rolling. What's your number three?
Well, my number three is going to be Mick Jagger, the Rooster Strut.
I had a feeling you were going to pick that, so I just I just kind of left it off my list.
All right. Yeah. Well, good for you. You know, I found a video from 1964, which is kind of the early evolution of Mick Jagger doing that move.
Even in these tiny little spaces that we had, you know, in the early days, it was just the natural thing to do.
But, you know, I saw the Stones in 78 on a Some Girls tour. One thing I remember is that Mick is just like all over the stage. And then later I saw him on the Steel Wheels tour. And if there's one guy in rock and roll that definitely stays zero body fat, no weight, yeah. It's Mick. Because yeah. The guy is, he probably runs 3 miles during a concert. But that move and all his other moves are... Yeah, Mick has a ton of classic moves.
That's what I was going to say. He has more than one move.
No, he's a dancing, you know.
Dancing fool.
Yeah, he's a maniac. Maniac on the stage. Mick has many classic moves. And if there's one guy definitely still going today... Because they're going to tour again.
That's crazy. You know, they're like 150 years old, seems like.
Man, I was on a recent vacation with my buddy Brian, and we were traveling the whole West, and we were at the Grand Canyon, and we were sitting at a bar, and I was talking to this guy sitting next to me, and he bought tickets already for the next tour.
Really?
But, you know, Mick is timeless.
Yeah.
And, you know, he's just...
Nobody else could do that move or the moves that he does and make it look cool.
Oh, yeah.
Rolling Stones' explosive combination of rock and roll wouldn't be the same without Mick Jagger's expressive vocals and uninhibited showmanship.
There are so many rock star moves that Mick kind of patented.
Yeah.
But I have to say the Rooster Strut is my number three.
Well, my number three, I don't know if you'd necessarily call it a move. I mean, it's a move, but not that kind of move. It is Stevie Ray Vaughan playing guitar behind his back. Jimi Hendrix and a lot of rock stars back in the day would play behind their back or play over their heads or play with their teeth. But I think Stevie Ray Vaughan perfected that move, because he could just, like, I don't even know how he did it. He would, like, just swing that guitar behind his back and just play effortlessly.
That move was first probably popularized back in the 40s.
Really?
Yeah, T-Bone Walker did it.
Did he really? Okay.
Oh, yeah, T-Bone played behind his head, did the splits, he did all this kind of stuff, and then Jimmy did it.
Really?
Jimmy famously did it. And yeah. then, of course, Stevie Ray Vaughan adopted it or yeah. adapted it from that. But, you know, Stevie definitely perfected it.
He did. He perfected it big time because he makes it look like, I mean, he puts no effort or thought into what he's doing.
But Jimmy did the same. And T-Bone.
I don't know. Did Jimmy actually play like this behind his back? Because I looked for a lot of videos and I couldn't find any. I saw him playing up here.
He definitely played behind.
But he never. I never saw any videos of him playing back
good
here.
Good point. I have to look at the T-Bone stuff. But T-Bone kind of started it, or at least I think somebody even before T-Bone might have done it. Jimmy definitely copped a lot of stuff from T-Bone. And then Stevie copped a lot of stuff from Jimmy.
What's that? What's that one? What's that?
Live at El Macambo.
Yeah, that's just freaking one of the best live performances.
I own it.
That ever existed, man.
On VHS,
and he's playing behind his back. It is like he's playing butter, man. That's my number three. What's your number two?
Number two is going to be Chuck Berry doing the duck walk.
I knew you were going to pick that, really? And that's why I didn't pick it.
Well, yeah, pick my brain again.
I picked it and unpicked it.
Yeah, that's the move where, you know, Chuck would crouch down and he would hop across the stage.
Yeah, yeah.
He always did it. Every time you saw Chuck, he would always do the duck walk.
Yeah, yeah.
I got to give it to Chuck. It's his. He owns it.
Yeah. Angus Young, I guess, kind of stole it from him,
Well, yeah. Angus is the other one that kind of stole it from Chuck. Yeah.
And he sort of took it to another level because Angus Young goes crazy on stage, man. Yeah. He like gets on the ground and, you know, spins around.
I'd have to say the duck walk by Chuck Berry is a classic signature rock star move. And I can't imagine seeing Chuck not doing it.
Yeah.
He had to do it every time he played.
Yeah. Because you'd be disappointed. You'd want your money back if you didn't do it.
Even in a wheelchair, he could probably do it. But anyways, that's my number two.
That's a good number two. Mm-hmm. Beer break. Well, my number two is Axl Rose doing the snake dance. Welcome to the jungle.
It's a classic move.
Especially on those early music videos, you know, that's when he was first, when we first saw it, you know, like him doing this, like.
With the big hair.
Yeah, with the big hair. He had the big hair in their early videos. Y'all usually starts around 7, we go on stage around 9, get on the bus about 11, sipping a drink and feeling fine. So there was a band called Shark Attack in the early 80s, and the lead singer was, his name was Richard Black. They were a part of the LA music scene at the same time when Guns N' Roses was coming up.
Okay.
And Axl Rose actually, he would go on stage and like play songs with these guys back in the day. They didn't even get a record deal until 89. And by that time, you know, the whole hair metal thing was like, you know, on the downslide. So, but Richard Black, he accused Axl Rose. Now, way later, he didn't do it at the time because he didn't, you know, he was like, he didn't want to be that guy. But in more recent years, he accused Axl Rose of stealing that move from him. Because they would perform on stage together.
Well,
And he actually says, oh, I do it way better than Axl does it.
Really? Yeah. Well, you know, that. Yeah, you know, Hollywood scene, and you know, all those metal bands or hard rock bands and stuff of the time, they went and saw each other.
Yeah, they were hanging out with each other.
Yeah. But they were probably copping moves and licks.
So. Yeah, and sharing girls and
petri dishes.
But you can even go further back than that. And Davy Jones of the Monkees actually does this move.
Really?
Early on, yeah. So maybe Axel stole it from Davy Jones, or he stole it from Richard Black, or Richard Black stole it from Davy Jones, and then who knows? Who knows?
One thing about rock star moves is there's few. I think Mick was original with the Rooster, but I mean they're all kind of, you know, going back.
Everybody copied each other. Yeah. Nothing's original, especially anymore these days. You know?
Yeah.
Everything's been copied. Everything's been done to a certain extent.
But yeah, that's definitely a signature move of Axl Rose.
And I wonder if he still does it.
Well, probably. I don't think he does it with AC/DC. Well, maybe he does. I don't know.
Who knows? Anyway, that's my number two. What's your number one? And I'm curious. I'm wondering if your pick is the same as mine, because my number one is probably the most famous in the world, worldwide for sure, but go for it. Let's see what it is.
There's a lot of famous ones out there, but I'm going to go with Pete Townsend's Windmill Straw.
That's a good one. It's not mine, but it's a good one.
I think it's perhaps the most famous rock star move out there. I watched this interview on David Letterman with Pete Townsend, back when Letterman was on.
Yeah.
Pete confessed that he kind of got it from Keith Richards, because they were opening up for the Stones back in the early days. And he saw Keith like, stretching and doing something like this.
Was he shooing away the mayflies?
Maybe. Like we are. But there was, it was probably 63 or something like that. And Pete says he saw Keith doing that move. And then later he went to Keith and said, "Hey man, what was that thing you were doing?" And Keith said, "I don't remember what the fuck you're talking about." So Pete said, "Okay, it's mine."
Yeah.
And he did it.
"You didn't do your arm swing thing." And he went, "What?" I said, "You know, that kind of windmilly thing, you know, your thing." And he went, "I can't tell you what he said."
Yeah.
Like, "I'm Keith Richards. Do you really think I'm gonna do ballet?"
You go back to the very beginning of The Who, like even on my generation, you can see that move that Pete was pulling off.
Have you ever tried to do that move before? It's not easy. It's not easy to do. It's easy to do this, but it's hard to hit the strings without tearing your fingers up.
I have a famous Rolling Stone magazine from the 80s. Still have it somewhere in the house, where Pete's got his hand up by his face and he's got blood running down his fingers.
Yeah.
Pete used to talk about doing that move, and he would shred his fingernails off his hand and be rendered, you know, bloody. Because when he'd hit it, he would hit it.
Yeah.
And Pete's always done it. And he's always...
I guess you could do it without actually hitting the strings and just maybe hitting the strings down here with your left hand. But when you try to actually hit the strings with a pick, it's almost impossible to do.
Yeah. I've seen The Who a couple times, going back to the late 70s and then, you know, later. And Pete always does that move, whether he's playing acoustic or whether he's playing electric. It's a very, you know, classic move by Pete Townsend. Of course, you know, Roger, not to be outdone, he had his own move. You know what that was?
Swinging the microphone?
Swinging the microphone.
I wonder how many people he hit in the head with that microphone.
I don't know.
Or how many times he missed and hit himself in the head.
Should have hit Keith a couple times. But if you ever look at the old Who videos, you'll see Roger's got the microphone, but it's all wrapped in tape.
Yeah.
Because he would have snapped that damn microphone off. But, you know, going back to, you know, Kids Are All Right, all the classic, you know, Who concerts, you'll see, you know, Roger. So, you know, Roger had his mic swinging and Pete had his windmilling.
Yep.
And there's a lot of breeze going on around there.
A lot of stuff going on.
Yeah. Yeah. But anyways, I think Pete Townsend's windmill move is my number one.
I agree. That's a great number one. My pick is maybe, I can see why you didn't pick my number one, because it's not really rock. It's more pop rock.
Mm-hmm.
But it's Michael Jackson doing the moonwalk.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It was up there.
So what made the moonwalk famous and worldwide was when he performed it in 1983 on Motown 25, that aired on probably, you know, ABC or something back in the day. And that's when everybody saw Michael Jackson doing the moonwalk.
And they went nuts.
And they went, I went nuts. Everybody went nuts. Because we were. I remember being, because this was 83, I was 12, you know, 13. And when he did that, I remember we all tried to figure out how he was doing the moonwalk.
You look at the audience shots and everyone is going berserk.
Yeah.
No one had ever seen that move before. And of course, he had so many, you know, popping and kind of moves in the day. But when he did the moonwalk, like this and, it was, you know, it was a...
One of a kind.
It was one of a kind.
Actually, the moonwalk goes back to the 1870s, if you can believe, if you can believe that. So I'm going to have to read this. So... in 1870, a guy named Arthur Marshall, who was an African-American composer, stated, if a guy could really do it, he sometimes looked as if he was being towed around on ice skates. So that was the first sort of like, oh, well, that's maybe a moonwalk. Maybe not.
But there weren't movies back then.
There weren't movies back then, but that's why it was just sort of a, you know, passed down through generations that this guy saw this somewhere down the line. But Cab Calloway and Charlie Chaplin in the 30s were doing something similar called the Buzz. What's really funny, in a November 1969 episode of H.R. Puffin Stuff, they do what they call the moonwalk, and it's pretty much a goofy dance, but there are a couple of instances of some moonwalk action going on.
Take your time until you learn to walk it, then we're gonna have a blast and rock it. Moonwalk, moonwalk.
It's gotta be hard to do with those costumes on.
Well, whoever this frog person was doing it.
Really?
I watched the video. I was like, oh my God, this is...
Well, you know, Michael's of the age to have grown up watching H.R. Puffin stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
Like me, so... Yeah. Maybe he just...
He could have, yeah.
He could have stored it away.
He could have said, hey, the moonwalk, I'll take that name. I'll take this little part that they're doing here and make it into, you know, part of what made him so famous and popular.
Michael had, like we talked about, had a lot of famous moves. In the glove, but that...
And the hair on fire.
Well, it wasn't his fault. But there was that... episode in music history when he whipped that out for the first time on national TV, and it kind of like solidified Michael's status as
King of Pop.
Not only a great singer, great performer, but a great dancer.
There was actually a lot more instances of moonwalk type dancing,
mm-hmm.
but I mean, I can't list them all because there was so many, really.
You know?
Yeah, it's crazy. But I mean, he took it and perfected it and made it, and he made it his own for sure. Yeah.
You know, there are so many signature rock star moves out there. I think about like Elvis's gyrating hips,
yep.
You know, David Lee Roth's, you know, gymnastics.
Yep.
ZZ Top spinning guitars, playing a guitar with your teeth, like Hendrix and Stevie and all those guys. But it really goes back to the beginning of rock and roll. And Jerry Lee Lewis kicking the, you know, stool out.
Yep.
It's been part of rock and roll since really the beginning of rock and roll. And that's what makes rock and roll great.
It is what makes rock and roll great.
It's the theatrics.
And what's sad that the last 20 years, there hasn't been a rock star or bands that know how to, like, add that element to their stage show.
I think there's a few, but, you know, you got your Bruno Marses and people like that. But
they're copying what's been done.
Sure.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it's a great topic, and we'd love to hear your suggestions. I'm sure we're leaving out several, but add it. You know, like it.
Comment below.
Comment. But thanks again, folks.
Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time in the shed.
All right. Bye-bye.